I think we're ready to get started. Thank you very, very much for being here today. I know on behalf of Mike, it means a great deal for every single person who is here. It's a special day, and we just define what this is about for us. Maybe somebody, this may be the first time you've ever attended a service like this, and if it is, let me just tell you what the flavor of this is for us. As Mike and I have talked, the heart of this, of an ordination service, is a local group of people who knows the person who's being ordained, who knows Mike, who are basically coming to say, we affirm, we agree, we sense, we perceive that God's calling you to do something very specific, and we're going to support that and be there as we basically send you out and bless that with our support, our loves, and our prayer, our love and prayer, and through a continuity of relationships that is so, so, so important. So we ask God's blessing on Mike today, and it's going to be a very special day. Just realize that your presence is more than observatory. You're not here just to watch. You're here as a part of what makes an ordination service an ordination service. So thank you on behalf of Mike for being here to make it as special as it's going to be. We're very thankful that we get the opportunity. I've known Mike for 10 years, and we'll share more of our story in just a little bit. There's a lot of color to that story. I do have one key question to ask you right off the... this is like, I don't know if you can really go all out into ministry unless you know this was asked from one of your close friends. Mike, do you know how to turn the boat motor on the boat straight so that the boat will drift correctly? Have you learned that one yet? I'm just asking. I know you probably have no idea who asked me that, but yeah. All right, if you would pray with me, we'll start. Father, we thank you so very much for Mike and what you're doing in his life, what you have done in his life, but also what you will do in his life. I'm thankful that grace is what qualifies us. That is your unmerited favor, not our performance or our education or anything. And God, I just thank you that I'm here to thank you that my mess-ups, my faults, my shortcomings don't disqualify me. In fact, in the realm of your grace, they make me more qualified because you redeem everything about life, the good and the bad and the ugly. And we are thankful for that today because we get to come put our arms around Mike literally and spiritually and say we agree. And with what he senses in his life, and we want to support and affirm that. We're asking you to bless him and make this service all that you intend for it to be, and we'll ask that in the great name of Jesus. Amen.
Hey, we're going to do a song that's pretty familiar to us here at Covenant. It talks about God's love, and that's exactly what got Mike to where he is today, and all of us for that matter. So I want to invite you to stand. You don't have to. You're more than welcome to stay seated as we sing together.
Once I was lost, wandering in darkness, no hope in sight, no hope in sight. But he called my name, and he healed my blindness, set me ablaze, and now I'm alive with his love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to awake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. And love never gonna let me go. And now my heart, so full of worship, I can't hold back, no, I can't contain it. For all he's done, Jesus my Savior, I am ablaze and full of thanks for his love breaking through my heart of stone, love breathing to awake my bones, love reaching out to save my soul, and love never gonna let me go, love calling me as I am, love making me new again, love lifting me when I can, and love never gonna let me go. And wherever you've been, and whatever you've done, come come as you are, come into his open arm. And wherever you've been, and whatever you've done, and come as you are, and come find his love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to awake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. And love never gonna let me go. Love calling me as I am. Love making me new again. Love lifting me when I can't. And love never gonna let me go.
Amen. You may be seated.
Son and Holy Spirit were together in perfect relationship before there was anything else that we know of. The holy relationship you had was totally fulfilling to you in perfection, which you resided in. It is such a lesson to us now that you treasured holy relationship so highly that you created everything that is, was, or ever will be in order to add to that treasure. It is people made in your image, us, whom you choose to add to your treasure chest in glory. Our minds can hardly perceive what you have done in this work of yours. It is your plan that we see you bringing us to yourself, to forever be the pinnacle of your creation, the objects of your love. As we are gathered here in your name, may we be humbled by this amazing love and yet bold to share it with all the rest you have made for this love. You are the only God there is. There is no other. Only darkness and lies pervert that truth. May we never suffer from doubting your love. May we learn to trust you in everything so that we can have the rest and peace that is only you. You have good plans for us all. Today and every day, let us rejoice in today. Thank you for your precious Son, who willingly stepped out of heaven to show us the way to you and bought us with his blood on the cross. You raised him on the third day and showed people that you have defeated death. Today, we have your Spirit in us. You never will leave us alone. We wait anxiously to join you in your throne room, Lord. Now use us as you will. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Dear friends, it's really amazing, isn't it? Today is amazing. Every day is, but today is today. Never let yourself not be amazed today. Today, God is still holding everything together in order to achieve his goal in us. The sun rises and falls. The moon and stars are held in their place by his mighty hand. Do not fear anything, for he truly has the whole world in his hands. Trust him, obey him, give thanks that he has provided everything we need to do that. Today is amazing. The King of Kings is getting his way with this common guy standing before you. You see, I know, just like you all know, Mike Reber is a real regular guy. When I was born, there were trains to catch and bills to pay, and I grew up in the usual way. And I was blessed. My parents taught me to pray. It was simple. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. And there was a song. It was, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, and my little girl's a blessing all the time. Many of you with gray hair probably remember that prayer and that song. It was a blessing. Younger people, I pray that you have memories that are just as rich. The wealth of believing in Jesus, believing in God, has been mine most of my life. I thank my mom and dad for being the kind of parents that a little boy could believe in unconditional love. They made me believing in God easy. There were bumps in the road. There were tears and sad words. Well, yes, there were, many of them in my own doing. And I learned about forgiveness. Early forgiveness given me when I was wrong, and later I learned the blessing of forgiving others the things done against me. Forgiving others is a slow thing with me. When I was a teenage boy, about 17 years old, a church lady told me I was going to go to hell. I didn't think she was right, but to me, she was the church. And I walked out, and I didn't set foot in the church for any real period of time other than a wedding or being a creaster on Christmas or Easter, and that was extremely rare. Until I was in my 30s, and I met a guy who talked to me, and he was a pastor of Covenant Baptist Church. He wanted to know about my eternal situation, my relationship with Jesus Christ. I told him that I believed in Jesus, and I believed that he died on the cross to pay for my sins. I'd confessed those sins, and I'd go to heaven someday. But I had a problem with Baptists. And I told him the story about the lady that told me I was going to hell. And he took it. And he loved me. And he gave me this little pamphlet to walk out of here with, out of this room right here. And he said, this is the Baptist faith and message. If you read this, this is who we are. And a couple weeks later, coming back into church, he asked me if I'd done what he asked. And I said, yeah, Rennie, I read that. I said, I believe every word that's in there. I guess I've been a Baptist all my life. The church is not always an easy ride. A lot of people are like me that got hurt and they spent years in the wilderness because of it. A friend of mine gave me a book a few years ago. It was about the decline of the church in North America over the last decades. And there was a story in it about the civil rights movements in the 60s when people were sitting in seats they weren't supposed to sit in, and people were enrolling in schools they weren't supposed to enroll in, and they were even rioting in the streets and making a big stink about it. And they had this guy named Martin Luther King that was their leader. And the guy that was writing this book about the decline of the church pointed out that during this period of time, the church had been largely mute about this civil rights stuff. And he wrote Martin Luther King a letter to ask him how he felt, because Martin Luther King, you know, was a reverend. He was a Christian preacher. And he asked Martin Luther King how he felt about the church and how he dealt with the church when the church really wasn't helping him out much. And he said, well, he says, I have been grieved by the church. He goes, but my Lord loves the church, so therefore so do I. And that kind of seals the deal for me. You know, some stuff does go wrong, but our Lord loves the church. And so therefore, me too. I mentioned being in the wilderness. I mentioned all those years away. And I want to bring this up because you guys are the first guinea pigs I've had for me talking to you about stuff. I've seen the church, and now the church is waking up to this too. I'm not bringing up brand new stuff. But for a long time, the church has been pretty satisfied with turn them into believers, make sure they've had their salvation experience, get them sat down in the pew, and we're all good. And the church is declining. And I've come to realize in the last couple of years, this can be kind of equated to like when Moses was leading the Hebrews out of Egypt and God did all those miracles for them, all those plagues that frustrated Pharaoh so much, and then ultimately when they left Egypt, he parted this ocean and they went through it, and then the ocean collapsed on Pharaoh's army trying to chase them down. So they were saved, were they not? And then God continued to try and keep his promises and take them to the promised land that he said he was going to give to them. And they didn't trust him. They sent scouts. Scouts came back. Some of them said, hey, there's giants in there. I don't think we should go in there. So they wouldn't go. And so the Lord left them in the wilderness for 40 years. And they did not know his peace and rest, which is what's happened to so many people that had their salvation experience, but they never learned to trust and obey and become like Jesus and follow Jesus and get to know Jesus and let the Holy Spirit that entered their bodies, into their hearts when they were saved. And he's there to do his job, but they were not engaging that. They were not trying to grow. They actually, all they needed to do is get to know him. Read their Bible, study his word, be amongst other believers, and let the spirit that was in them too bounce off the spirit that's in you, and let him change us from within, where we would find the peace and rest of knowing and trusting the Lord. And so, today I'm talking to you all that might, who I don't know, but if you feel like you're kind of in the wilderness and you feel like life's tossing you stuff that you're having a hard time handling, it really, I think it's because you need more of him. You need to come talk to me. Find a brother or a sister to talk to and read your Bibles and trust that he will do what he said he'll do. One of the things I learned a long time ago that really caught my attention was Jesus said, the kingdom of God is at hand. And he wasn't talking about we're all about to die. He was talking about now, here in this world, the kingdom of God is at hand. And that is the transforming life that's available to us here and now by knowing Jesus, following Jesus, so as I am approaching and accepting and going to surrender myself to this call that has brought us all here today, I'm going to really stick to that end of the book of Matthew and go and make disciples. That's what I'm going to do. That's my goal, is to make disciples so that, when I find an unbeliever, I'll try to show him the way to salvation, but I'm not going to leave him in the wilderness for the rest of his life. I want him to realize that there is a good life, a blessed life, a safe, secure life today. We don't have to wait for tomorrow because we have today, and he is in it, and he is fighting for us. He's in total control of it. God is amazing. He is relentless. I suggest being more obedient. And Pastor Casey's been a close friend of mine for 10 years. He has encouraged me all along. We've been talking about this day for 10 years. I'm just a regular guy. I read about Moses, and I remember what he said to God. He said, I can't talk to people, stuff like that. But I've been stuck in the mud, and I wanted to serve, and I have served, and I've done a lot of things, but I've been holding back, and I'm not holding back anymore. Pastor Casey has supported me huge all along, and there's a lot of other people in this room that have supported me as well. I've been really stubborn. As this past February, I told Casey I was ready to be ordained. He and the elders of this church have paved the way for me. Casey asked me a couple weeks ago if I had seen any changes since I had surrendered to this call. Until he asked, I hadn't really thought about it. But here's the facts. Man, do I feel a lot of relief. And man, my ministry has grown. There's more guys and people involved in what I'm doing than there was in February. There's more. My influence has been expanded, and I trust that this is just the beginning. I praise God for everything he says, and he is. Pastor Casey and the elders, I'm ready. Praise God. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mike. That's good. My first memory of Mike's going to be down in the basement, Dwayne Dell's Sunday school class, and Mike walking me up the stairs saying, I've been through a lot with a lot of pastors, but I'm going to tell you one thing, I'm going to stick by you no matter what. Now, I don't know if he knew that I was going to be a long time here. So he might have been thinking, 3 or 4 years, I'm by your side. You go past that, we'll have to renegotiate. But he has kept his word. He's been one of my most ardent supporters, not that I have an agenda, but in terms of encouragement and support and friendship and consistency. My second memory of Mike is him showing me a really good hunting spot that I've killed a lot of turkeys in still today. I knew we were destined to be friends for a long term. But I will tell you something. I think Mike would be, I didn't ask him his permission. I'm still not going to ask his permission. But we've not just had fair weather days, have we? It's been some bumps in our friendship, in our lives, and everything. And the true test of friendship is that it endures through all of that. Because I'll tell you the honest truth is the only thing, not the only thing, but the thing that has brought Mike and I back together is we've done this sometimes, not much, especially over 10 years. I can't believe it's been 10 years. But it's Jesus. It really is. We can agree always that he is the center point of all of it. You know, one of my favorite memories, this was early on, and Mike, I told him early, man, I think he asked me, he may not have asked me, I don't know, we've had the discussion, is, you know, what do you think about deer hunting on Sunday? I said, sometimes I wish I could do that. I told him that, and he's like, but you can do that, because you don't have to be here at a certain time, and da da da. So one time Mike came, he had just had a successful deer hunt, and this was way back in the day. I think we still had risers back here, didn't we, where we had a small choir still going on. Now, mind you, if you know Mike at all, this won't surprise you, that he came in largely in his hunting apparel. So he was camouflaged. He had rubber boots up to here. Now, the thing that was different that day is that there was evidence of his success on his boots. So without saying any more, there was evidence that a harvest had been made. Okay, and I didn't know what to think about this because I've been, you know, saying, hey, come as you are, you know, it's all good. And Mike's going to get up and stand in the choir and sing with blood on his boots. I was like, Mike, I'm really not this way, but I think we're going to do a foot washing this morning. And so we did. I went to the bathroom and said, come here. I got down and I washed his boots off. That's the true story. I washed his boots off. That's my story of washing Mike's feet. Now, I'm waiting for that to be reciprocated, but it hadn't been done. Through and through, I mean, tons of stories come to mind when I think about 10 years of relationship. And what I want to do is challenge Mike with 7 of the most vital things that I've learned in those 10 years. A lot of that has been in relationship with Mike, as we've read books together. The Present Future was probably our first venture of a co-read book, and then hearing Reggie McNeil at Western Hills and kind of dealing with a lot of what you talked about today. But I want to challenge you with 7 things, and I'm going to go through them fairly quickly because this is aimed at everybody. We all need to know this. Typically in an ordination service, I would preach a challenge to the candidate and give a challenge to the church. But in this message, I want you to hear the challenge to both sides, okay? These are very, very important things. They're probably not typical, but they're from my heart and from experience. And I told Mike before this, so these are probably things you already know, but we're going to nail them down today. And the first thing, Mike, in ministry, people are the priority, not programs. You know that. I'm not sharing anything new with you there. But when Jesus said, the Son of Man has come to seek and save the lost in Luke 19:10, he made that the priority. That you could literally say, this is a hard thing to swallow in one respect, that God could say, you're my priority on this earth. It sounds like we're elevating ourselves to some, you know, exalted position where it's uncomfortable, but when Jesus said he came to this earth to seek us out, he said, that's a pretty high elevation of priority. And one day Jesus, the scripture says, it was teaching on this in one of the synagogues. It says, this is in Luke chapter 13, 10 through 17. I'm going to read this story to you real quick. It's a really neat story. And a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit. For 18 years, she had been crippled by a spirit. She was bent over and couldn't straighten up at all. And when Jesus saw her, when Jesus laid eyes on this woman, he called her forward and said to her, woman, you're set free from your infirmity. You're healed, in other words. Then he put his hands on her. And immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue leader, indignant because Jesus had helped this woman stand up straight for the first time in years and years and years, the synagogue leader said to the people, there are 6 days for work. Listen to this. There are 6 days for work. So come and be healed on one of those days, not on the Sabbath. Can you believe somebody would say that? They did. The Lord Jesus answered and said, you hypocrites. Doesn't each one of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on a Sabbath day from what bound her? When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated. But the people were delighted. All his opponents were humiliated, but the people were delighted with all the wonderful things he was doing. It's because people were always the priority to Jesus. Not a program, not an institution, not even his reputation. People. And you remember,
that you'll never be immune from the temptation to make a program a priority. You'll never be immune from that. But never do it. Never let it happen. Luke 10:27, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, period. I know you get it. Here's another thing, Mike, I want you to do, and I know that you do this, you digest books quicker than I do, but never stop learning and improving as a pastor, as a student of people, and a student of God's Word, and a communicator. Read more and more and solicit input and feedback. Yes, it is dangerous feeling to say, what do you think of this? To submit a manuscript to somebody else for their scrutiny, to ask somebody their honest feedback on something that you've done or a plan that you have. But I would suggest to you there's no better way to grow. That's why 2 Timothy 2:15, Paul says to Timothy, he says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who doesn't need to be ashamed, who correctly handles the word of truth. Do your best. And to do your best, we have to constantly allow others to speak into our lives, constantly allow others to give constructive criticism. I would encourage you, and I know that you will, but make sure that the relationships are firm and trustworthy with those people that you're soliciting. You don't want to be unnecessarily criticized in a harmful way, but it is very important to pick those you trust to give you true feedback to who you are and where you're going and what you're becoming. Mike, this one's number three is becoming versus behaving should be the priority of our message. Here's the heart of that, and you know this, and you said this in what you just talked about, that our message that we herald as preachers, as pastors, as communicators, is that we are here to herald the truth that we can become like Jesus. We don't have to just learn to behave for him. That this is not about following rules. It's about following a person, and in the following of the person, we can actually become like the person, which is the whole heartbeat and the essence of what a disciple does. I know you get that. And I know you know Romans 12:2 that says, don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will. Fourthly, let God's word be the relentless authority in your life and ministry, no matter what. Again, Mike, you get this, but we have had honest discussions about, wow, where does this break over? How does this apply? What does this look like? What does it mean today? And I know that after 10 years of doing life and ministry with you as your friend and as your pastor, that Mike's going to break on the side of God's word and the authority of it. Now, I'm going to challenge you in front of God's people today, as much for you as it is for him, that he be held to that standard and always accountable, always pointed back, always pushed towards the ultimate authority of God's word. Because listen, here's a fact that is true of everybody in here that proclaims, teaches, and admonishes others with God's word. There are going to be times that you'll be tempted to fudge on that and say, I want to, and just move a little bit more towards preference, to move a little bit more towards style, and to maybe compromise a little bit on the distinct and authoritative word of God as the final say in a matter. Maybe it makes it easier for us. Maybe it reduces the amount of conflict. Maybe it helps our image or whatever we might think. I'm going to challenge you to remember that the Bible says in Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It penetrates to dividing the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges thoughts and attitudes of the heart. In 2 Timothy 3:16, I'll remind you that it says all scripture is God-breathed. All of it's inspired. Not some of it, not parts of it, not our preferred parts, not the favorite verses, but all of it, and is all useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And I'll remind you, as it says that, it teaches and rebukes and corrects and trains us first, and others second. Otherwise, it becomes a sword that does damage. Fifth thing is practice, pursue, and model humility above all else. There may be no greater attribute, no greater character trait that would be helpful in ministry than this one. That is to listen, to care, to identify, to empathize, to express patience, to make sure that others are ahead of you, that God is ahead of you. And I would say it like this, Mike, never, ever desire to be needed. Never desire to be needed. Always be willing, but never, never strive to create a dependence upon us. Never make yourself a funnel. Never make yourself essential to other spiritual growth. always consider it a profound blessing, an incredible privilege, when God allows us and chooses us to enhance or bless or to serve somebody else. I don't know of any other way to say this than what Matthew said, what Jesus said in Matthew. It says, those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. And humility is not really something, it's not like a posture we take. It really is a mindset and attitude that we embrace that's authentic, that's really truly others first, me second. And that's why James says it like this, and I don't know that anybody says it better than him in James chapter 4, when it says, Do you think the Scripture says without reason that God jealously longs for the Spirit He has caused to dwell in us, but He gives us more grace? That's why the Scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God, and resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. So you know when pride has set in. I know from experience, okay? And many of you might know from experience. Mike probably knows from experience when pride sets in. And in ministry, so to speak, you just begin to feel the wind of God's Spirit no longer at your back. The effortlessness and the joy and the peace and the contentment that kind of is the current of God's movement in your life just kind of goes to a standstill, if not feeling like you're moving against the headwaters of a raging torrent. When pride sets in, the power and the essence of God's blessing seems to wither and dry almost instantaneously, whether it's up here preaching, whether it's in a face-to-face meeting, whether it's in a quiet time. Man, pride will absolutely destroy everything that's essential. Now, I don't know that there's anything more destructive it has been in my life than thinking or acting like I can do life on my own, much less ministry. Grace and more grace. Mike, you could stand up here and tell me this, okay? You've taught me this. What the depths and the fathomless limits of God's grace is. But here's something that God kind of showed me as I was working on this. And I think this was good for me. We do not necessarily, we always talk about extending grace. You and I have talked about extending grace, but what maybe we might be a little off there. Now hold on with me, okay, before you say, wait, don't change your whole doctrine of grace. Well, I'm not. I'm saying that God's present power of grace that is inherent in you is not what we extend, but what we extend comes out of the grace that we've received. That is, we extend love, mercy, and forgiveness by the power of grace that's in us. God's undeserved love, His favor, that empowers us to do what we do, which means we extend love, mercy, forgiveness towards others. I think God extends grace to us, and by that we extend those things to other people. Out of the fullness we've all received grace in place of grace already given. John 1:16 says that, but where sin increased, grace increased all the more. Romans 5:20, but he said to me, my grace, Paul struggling and saying, man, God pleading, Paul pleading with God to remove the thorn in his flesh, whatever that was, the problem that he had, and God's response is, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. His grace is evident, profoundly evident in your life. Continue to let it to yield the results that it's led you to up into this point. And one thing I've realized this is so powerful is that that grace is not just something we receive, but it's a powerful entity that is in us, that moves us, that God uses to transform. And so it allows us to do this one thing that is imperative in ministry, that is, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. So, Mike, I didn't tell you, it's hard when I know somebody as well as I know you, and I know that where you stand on all these things, it's hard to say them, because I know you get this. I know I'm not necessarily informing, but I do want to charge you, as well as this congregation of people that have gathered around you, to hold you to those things. Not only those things, not to the scope of, just limited to the scope of those things, but I would, if I were to take seven things and say I was going to build a ministry on them, this is where I would start today. That's where I, not necessarily start for you, but these are the things I would challenge you to make sure are inherent in everything you do, that they serve as guidelines, as boundaries to move you ahead. Never move without the scope. I don't think that I could, I am certain that I could tell you today that none of those things is dispensable. None of those things is optional. There are probably more, but those things have defined who I am as a pastor today, and I've found them absolutely essential to make sure that I am able to live under the leadership of God's Spirit. So I trust your heart, and I appreciate your heart, and I know that today is a very meaningful today. I wanted to stand up when you were first starting. I said, you know, I just need to tell everybody Mike leaks, okay? He just leaks. And that is when his heart, this is one of the most tender-hearted guys, for a guy's guy, this guy has a heart that is compassionate, kind, and tender-hearted as the day is long. He will love people relentlessly and fearlessly. And it takes a heart of courage to do that, but it also takes a tender heart. And that's one of the things I really admire about you. It wasn't long before, after we met, before you were wiping your nose and eyes, because we're just talking. I'm like, has he got really bad allergies, or is he really this caring, this sensitive? And he is. And I got to tell you, that's something I admire. I truly, deeply, profoundly respect that. To let your heart be. And as you preach to people, when God gives you that platform on a regular basis, never, ever let that stop. Okay? Promise me? All right. I know. Let's call it a choice. We're going to ask for a very special time when Mike's going to come up here, and we're just going to ask that all those who are in ministry, ordained, and called to certain offices of ministry, that God's, whether you're an elder or a deacon or a pastor, or some variation thereof, we're just going to ask you to come and put your hands on Mike as he gathers here in just a moment. And we're just going to pray that God would bless his ministry. Because literally, in and about Mike, or how qualified he is, or anything, is about the power of God working through a willing person to advance the gospel and help people become like Jesus. So that's what we're going to pray for. So Mike, why don't you come on up here? Okay? Those of you that would come pray over him. Listen, no one's excluded for this prayer. Come on, anybody and everybody. No one's excluded from this, okay? And really, one of the only reasons we would say is because if everybody gathers up here, we'll never finish, okay? So you can agree with and endorse and bless and right where you're at, whether you're here or not, okay? All right, y'all gather in tight around him. And if you can get a hand on him, that's fine. If you can't, that's fine. God'll understand. And anybody can start. Larry, you want to start over there, and we'll work this way. You do not feel compelled to have to pray out loud. We understand if you're praying in agreement up here, but if you want to voice a prayer aloud for Mike, you go right ahead and do that. Go ahead.
Thank you for this time today. Thank you for this opportunity.
Yes.
To be here and exclaim this brother, lift him up before you and proclaim your blessings upon him. You know, Father, it's in your will for him to go forth, continue to minister, as he has, but in new ways also.
Yep.
Father, I ask that you give him strength, give him grace, your mercy, and your love in proportions that he can't contain. It just overflows.
Yes.
Already has a pastor's heart, it's obvious, and I pray that blessing on his family, that today would be something in their mind that they could remember, that today Mike was bold enough to step forward and to preach the word of God and to let people know of the love of Jesus Christ. Father, give him strength and give him wisdom and give him the ability to continue to go forward, because there's times coming that he'll be pushed down and knocked around. And Lord, I just ask that he continue to get up.
Yeah.
That you would give him grace and you would give him humility and that you would give him a strength that only you can give us when we're down.
Yeah.
And Father, I ask your blessings on all that he does from this day forward through the words of Jesus Christ, our Heavenly Father.
Lord, I thank you for Mike's tender heart and his genuine love for others. That is an inspiration to me and to all who know him. And Lord, there's so many people that are lost that are crying out for the kind of love that only Jesus has and that is flowing through Mike. And so I pray that you lead him to many who are ready to hear the word, ready to learn about the love that you have for them, and that you would use him in a mighty way to draw many to you into relationship with you and into that abundant life with you.
Lord, you've seen this occur with lots of thought, lots of consideration by his pastor and elders. Lord, this has not been done in a corner. And you see us here, Lord, with our hands upon him. And may our hands be as your hands. And Lord, may everyone here always remember this special moment in time when you have anointed this man to do your work. And we thank you in Jesus' name.
Father, we're grateful for the way we've seen Jesus represented in Mike's life in the past. We come today recognizing that and the gift of Jesus that exudes from him. We ask, Father, that these years that he has before him, these days before him, the relationships will grow and more people will come to know and honor Jesus because of it. Father, guard his heart, keep his focus on you. Allow him, Father, to be affirmed, not just by this church, but by his God.
Yeah.
Father, as he's challenged, may he persevere. Father, may we see even more about people coming to know Jesus, understanding more of his grace, your grace.
Father, today as we put our hands on Mike's shoulders, I really want to ask you to make him aware that that's your hand. The weight of our hands is the weight of your approval on him. You've redeemed him. You bought him back with the blood of your own son. You rescued him, filled him with your spirit. You've erased his sins. You've made him righteous in Jesus. He is not starting ministry today. This is not the beginning. This is an affirmation of what you've really already done and a new phase of that's coming. And God, as I was thinking as people were praying, if Mike feels like he's resisted a call for some time, but I don't know that that would be true. I do think today is the day, now is the moment that you have asked him to step forward. And that there will be a new perspective in him, and maybe a new lightness about ministry. But God, he's been loving people and pastoring and shepherding and encouraging and ministering in many, many ways. Now he's just affirming in front of everybody that this is the call that you have on him. And God, if you would open up the doors for him to pastor, to shepherd a church, we would be so pleased. I know it's his heart. I know that's his desire.
And we just want to ask you to make it happen like you want it to happen, that he would never step through doors that you didn't open, that he'd not kick any down, he'd not shut any on his own, that he'd simply be willing to wait and to watch, that we, the people standing here today, and even the ones seated here today, would be willing to speak into that process, to be open about what we think and feel and perceive. And God, we're asking you to surround Mike with an army of people to encourage him and affirm him. And God, make his ministry so fruitful, so exciting. Help him to measure the right things, God. Help him to value the right things, to major on majors, to minor on minors, to keep doing what he does best, to offer grace and to love people and to proclaim the gospel so that your kingdom would grow in great, great ways. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you all.
So did you wash your boots this morning?
Well, 6 inches of water in the basement though.
Yeah.
Hey, just going to have you remain seated. If you know the song we're about to do, please jump right in. And if you catch on to it really quick, jump right in as well. Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back. I've been set free, and Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me, and everything I need is in you, and everything I need. Christ, my all in all, the joy of my salvation, and this hope will never fail, 'cause heaven is our home. And through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here. To God be the glory, and Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me, and everything I need is in you, and everything I need. And I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough, and Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me, and everything I need is in you, and everything I need. Sing this together. I have decided. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back,
No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
God bless you.
I know on behalf of my brother Mike, if anybody starts treating him different, it's not going to feel good, all right? So if you say, oh, you are an ordained minister, I'm going to apologize every time I say a wordy dirt or say something. Don't do that. Don't treat him any differently, okay? All right? He is still Mike Reber, and all you've done is affirm God's call in his life, and that's a huge thing. But he didn't have a halo now, all right? God bless you. Let's have a good time and start fellowshipping together. Thank you.